Welcome to DivCasts from University of Chicago Divinity School. For more of our podcasts and information about our terms of use, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts.
Perhaps let me say we'll be getting out of the way in just a few minutes. This will be in the form of a seminar, really. So you're welcome to sit up more closely if you like. And please help yourself with some of the good food. And we'll probably wait just a couple more minutes. I think there's someone who's trying to begin, and so in a couple minutes we'll begin.
And there's handouts of a short excerpt from it, and seeing us online, it's just one page right back. Everyone should have it on.
And are there copies on the back?
Yeah, there's copies on the back table there.
Well, before we begin, I just want to mention that one of the thoughts from the previous session this morning that came to mind, and I just wanted to pass it on to Dr. Mustafa, is that his firm belief that translation requires a person to become a literary animal in both languages. And that the engagement with how to confront the untranslatable place in a creative way. I just thought that would be nice, and I want to thank Kate for bringing that to mind. Today, now we're going to have a discussion of that Kamala Kitani will lead, where this came out of a conversation we had about what Kamala Kitani would like to be doing this afternoon, and to talk about the way that biographical and autobiographical literature in the classical Arabic past informs modern creative literature today, or can inform. And Nathaniel Miller, who is a PhD student in Melk, will be helping us out here as our official moderator. With that, Kamal, please introduce the text any way you like. We can read some of it together if you like, and we can even translate it as we go along if you wish. But if you could give us a sense of how you came across this text, the classical text on Oyun and Atiba, and how it has impacted your own writing and thought.
And then أتكلم عن هدف التراجم عام مثلا.
That's the next session.
بعدين.
المحاضرة الجاية.
نعم. السلام عليكم. هذا النص نادر وغريب ومدسوس، يعني غير رغم أنه ينتمي إلى فيلسوف عظيم وكبير هو ابن سينا، لكن لم يأتي في أحد كتب ابن سينا، لم يذكر أيضا في كتب التراجم المشهورة التي ترجمت لابن سينا وأهمها على الإطلاق وفيات الأعيان لابن خلكان. ورد في كتاب يترجم للأطباء، كتاب طبقات الأطباء لابن أبي قصيبعة، وهو يترجم للأطباء الإغريق واليونان والعرب. وفي هذا الكتاب نص أملاه ابن سينا على أبو عبيد الجوزجاني في فترة في عصره، وفيه يتحدث عن نفسه. لماذا ابن سينا في كتاب الأطباء؟ لماذا ابن سينا تضمنه كتاب الأطباء؟ لأن الفيلسوف في التراث العربي وفي الشعبي لابد أن يكون على معرفة بالطب، وإذا كان طبيبا فقط يدرج في الفلاسفة. ولذلك في الريف المصري وفي المناطق الشعبية حتى الآن الطبيب يسمى بالحكيم. يعني أنا أقول في بيتنا أنا رايح للحكيم، الحكيم هو الفيلسوف، لأن الفلسفة كانت جزء من الطب والاثنين كانوا في المعبد. يعني كان في ملاحظة على اهتمامي بالعمارة أن الجامعات الكبرى في العالم فيها شبه بالعمارة الدينية مثل جامعة شيكاغو. يعني نحن نشعر أننا نجلس في كنيسة، لأن العلم كان في الدين، كان في الموقع، كان في المعبد المصري، ثم المعبد الإغريقي، ثم مكتبة اسكندرية، ثم الأزهر. الأزهر ما كانش للعلوم الشرعية فقط، يعني كان يدرس فيه علم المياه، علم الفلك، الطب. فدائما في علاقة ما بين العلم وما بين الدين.
الأزهر يلخص شوية ويترجم شوية. Nathaniel, could you give us a little bit?
So we're looking here at the autobiography, well, this autobiographical selection from Ibn Sina, but it's not actually found in Ibn Sina's texts. It's found, curiously enough, in a collection of biographical notices about doctors, all of that. So he was just saying that there is a relationship between philosophy and medicine. Even in many of the Arabic dialects today, people call a doctor Hakim, which means like a wise man or something, including in Upper Egypt, where he's from. He sees in the Egyptian culture there is a relationship in ancient Egypt around the temple between medicine and philosophy.
And which do you have anything?
No, he's not at
all. Let me just mention a couple points in addition that I thought would be relevant. This notion that one of the nice things I thought Gamal pointed out was the notion that religion and hard science have gone together, and that medicine and astronomy and other hard sciences were practiced by priesthoods or in the ancient times, or connected with religious institutions like Al-Azhar in Egypt. And then Gamal pointed around here and said, we noticed that this university itself has a connection with religion. Right. So thank you, and let us go on.
أهمية هذا النص، النص قديم فيلسوف كبير يتحدث فيه عن نفسه. هذا نادر في العرب العربي ان يكون الكاتب والمكتوب عنه شخص واحد. سيتطور الامر فيما بعد، سنتحدث عندما نتحدث عن عدد التراجم حول هذا الفن. لكن انا ساقرا ما قاله ما املاه ابن سينا على ابو عبيد الجزجاني حول حياته.
Okay, so he is saying that it's rare in the classical period to find a writer writing about himself in this direct fashion. And he is now going to read some of the texts that Ibn Sina recounted to someone of his own generation, who then passed it on to Ibn Abi Husayba, who put it in this dictionary of biographical notices of Docs.
يقول ابن سينا: إن أبي كان رجلا من أهل بلخ، وانتقل منها إلى بخارى في أيام نوح ابن منصور، واشتغل بالتصوف وتولى العمل في أثناء أيامه بقرية يقال لها خرميتا من ضياع الخر، وهي من أمهات القرى، وبقربها قرية يقال لها أفشنا. تزوج أبي منها بوالدتي وقطن بها وسكن، وولدت منهما بها، ثم ولدت أخي، ثم انتقلنا إلى بخارى وأحضرت معلم القرآن ومعلم الأدب، وأكملت العشر من العمر وقد أتيت على القرآن وعلى كثير من الأدب حتى كان يقضي مني العشر. وكان أبي ممن أجاب داعي المصريين ويعد من الإسماعيلية. في هذا الوقت كان الفاطميين بيحكموا مصر، وقد سمع منهم ذكر النفس والعقل على الوجه الذي يقولونه ويعرفونه هم، وكذلك أخي، وكانوا ربما تذكروا بينهم وأنا أسمعهم وأدرك ما يقولونه ولا تقبله نفسي. وابتدأوا يدعونني أيضا إليه ويجرون على ألسنتهم ذكر الفلسفة والهندسة وحساب الهند. وأخذ يوجهني إلى رجل كان يبيع البقل ويقوم بحساب الهند حتى أتعلمه منه. ثم جاء إلى بخارى أبو عبد الله النائلي، وكان يدعى المتفلسف، وأنزله أبي دارنا رجاء تعلم منه. وقبل قدومه كنت أشتغل بالفقه والتردد فيه إلى إسماعيل الزاهر، وكنت من أجود السالكين، وقد ألفت طرق المطالبة ووجوه الاعتراض على العديد على الوجه الذي جرت عادة القوم به.
Okay, so let us have a summation, and then if anybody has any discussions or questions about this passage, we'll be able to read the whole text. So let us have a quick summation. Who would like to summarize it? Wetchy, would you like to?
Sure. I mean, translate it maybe back.
Okay, that's fine.
So my father descends from the town of Balakh, and he moved to Bukhara in the days of Nuh ibn Mansur, and he devoted himself to asceticism. I don't know if some other people want to help me. And he worked in those days in this village that is called Karmadin, one of the outskirts of Bukhara, and it is one of the major villages at the time. And next to it, there is another village called Afshina, where my father married met one of the women there and married her, and he lived and dwelt in that place. I was born from them in that place. Then my mother gave birth to my brother, and we all moved to Bukhara. I joined the teachers of Quran and the teachers of literature. When I reached 10 years old, I completed learning the Quran, in the sense he could tell it from his heart, and learned a lot of literature until it became, I became a model that at that age he learned the Quran and learned all a lot of literature. I think to Al Quran, I will translate. Yeah, I understand that. I finished the whole thing.
I began to study it.
I think. So, what do you think?
I'm not sure.
So because for me, I think to Al Quran, على كثير من الأدب, and then until I became like a mar, حتى يأخذ مني العجب, and I would understand that in the sense of because أتى على شيء means also to complete it.
Yeah.
To finish it.
Right.
And that makes sense why he's like a marvelous thing. At 10 years old, he finished the Quran, learned a lot of literature. So, كان أبي أجاب داع المصريين, and my father joined the
Islamizing activities of the Egyptian Falcon, the Egyptians that are finished yet in Egypt at that time.
Mm-hmm. قد سمع منهم ذكر نفسه بعض الأشياء.
So who heard from them? The father?
The
father heard the soul with a capital S, or what they said about the soul and the intellect, the way that they understand.
Yeah,
absolutely.
قد سمع منهم in the sense of following them, learned from them. And the same for my brother. And ربما تذكروا بينهم وأنا أسمع, maybe they discussed amongst each other while I would be listening to their discussions, and I understand what they say, even though ولا تقبله نفسي, even though it's not really accepted by my soul, meaning like I understand their philosophy, but really not agreeing with it. And they started inviting me even to the discussions.
So he's not saying I was a kid and I didn't quite understand what they were saying. He was saying I was completely.
Yeah,
just
about
it.
Yeah, exactly.
It sounds like his brother or his father didn't think they probably thought he was just a young boy there. Mm-hmm. But he was saying I was listening, I was getting it, but I wasn't really there.
Which is wrong.
It wasn't my okay.
Well, especially if the brother is younger, because he says after that my brother was born.
Yeah.
The younger brother. So, but they started wanting him to join too.
Yeah. And they were discussing matters of philosophy, geometry, mathematics. Said the end. I'm not sure about the end.
Indian
numbers.
Yeah, there's decimal places.
So geometry and arithmetic.
Yeah. وأخذ يوجهني إلى رجل كان يبيع البقل, and he directed me to this man who was a trader of.
Groceries,
yeah. And was a master or Yaqum Bik Sebil in like this, the Indian numbers, so that I learned from him. And then Abu Abdullah Al-Nahi came from Bukhara, and he was called the philosopher. And my father invited him to our house in the hope that he teaches me. And before he came, I was at that time studying fiqh, jurisprudence, and I used to frequent like the company of this Ismail Zahid to study jurisprudence.
Is there any significance to كان يتعب المتفلسف instead of فلسوف؟
ثم ابتدأت بكتاب
We had a question. The question was, is the fact that this grocer was called Mutafalsif rather than Faylasuf, does this mean that Ibn Sina didn't think much of his abilities? That he did not respect his abilities?
إنه هنا يقول ابن سينا عن هذا الرجل القادم أنه متفلسف وليس فيلسوف. هل نفهم من ذلك ما ربما أن ابن سينا لم يعتقد بأن هذا الشخص حقيقة فيلسوف؟
لا هو كلمة متفلسف يعني يدعي الفلسفة، لكن فيلسوف يعني معترف به وأبيز من أساتذة وحقيق، لكن متفلسف الذكاء الشديد لابن سينا وتكونه مبكرا. هو يشرح لنا هنا كيف تكون، هذا مهم يا مفهوم.
So it's noteworthy to remark here that the intelligence of Ibn Sina, the learning, all these resources at an early age, and also agreeing and disputing with others. So
ثم ابتدأت بكتاب إسراغوغي على النائل. كتاب إسراغوغي هو من الكتب اليونانية القديمة التي ترجمت في عصر الخلافة العباسية. عندما يقول على النائل أي شرح النائل لكتاب إسراغوغي. هذا ثم ابتدأت بكتاب إسراغوغي على النائلين. ولما ذكر لي حد الجنس إنه هو المقول على كثيرين مختلفين بالنوع في جواب ما هو، فأخذت في تحقيق هذا الحد بما لم يسمع لمثله، وتعجب مني كل العجب، وحذر والدي من شغلي بغير العلم. ده مين؟ النائل اللي هو اللي درس ابن سينا في نفس الوقت. وكان أي مسألة قالها لي أتصورها خيرا منه، حتى قرأت ظواهر المنطق عليه، وأما دقائقه فلم يكن عنده منها خبرة. ثم أخذت أقرأ الكتب على نفسي وأطالب الشروح حتى أحكمت علم المنطق، وكذلك كتاب أقليدس، فقرأت من أوله 5 أشكال أو 6 عليه، ثم توليت بنفسي حل بقية الكتاب بأسره، ثم انتقلت إلى المجسطين. ولما فرغت من مقدماته وانتهيت إلى الأشكال الهندسية، قال إن إلي تولى قراءتها وحلها بنفسك، ثم أعرضها عليك لأبين لك صوابه من خطأه،
وما كان الرجل يقوم بالكتاب وأخذت فحل ذلك الكتاب فكم من شكل ما عرفه إلى وقت ما عرفته عليه ومهمته إياه. ثم فارقني النائبي متوجها إلى التركان، واشتغلت أنا بتحصيل الكتب والنصوص والشروح من الطبيعي والإلهي، وصارت أبواب العلم تتفتح علي. جملة جميلة جدا يا ولد.
ما ترجع بحضر
اتوصل الحته دي. هو بدا يتعلم بنفسه، يعني هو كان يسبق استاذه، لكن الجمله شوف الجمله الحداثه فيها وصارت ابواب العلم تتفتح عليه، يعني أصبح يستوعب العلم بدون مجهود. هذا طبعاً ده عبقري. شو يا سيدي؟
I think for this one.
دلوقتي ولا بعدين؟
I think for this one we can have a shorter summary because some of the other paragraphs are going to have thicker implications. So perhaps we just have a summary of this. And then reference to the last sentence.
So he says in this paragraph that he started reading the commentaries of Nei on Isagu, Uji. They were discussing the levels of the species. And basically the summary of this part is that Ibn Sina used to challenge his professors, and to the point that Nei actually warned his father that Ibn Sina is erring in the wrong direction, and then Ibn Sina went further by starting to read on alone. So basically that's the I don't know if you want to add to
I think what the teacher is saying, don't let him do anything else except scholarship. You know, he's too good. Don't let him go and be a ba'al or something like that. He must be a scholar. He's very good. But then he starts to read on himself, not on the humanity. He starts to teach himself.
Yeah.
And these are the standard medieval texts, the Isagoga and the Almagest and all these Greek texts are the standard ones in the medieval philosophical curriculum that we usually don't meet because, of course, philosophy was right? It wasn't to be acknowledged too openly. And maybe because he was in an Ismaili household, he had more access to this sort of thing. So we rarely hear about it, but when we do, this is the standard curriculum, and he's still just over 10.
And it's
true. Oh, and the last sentence he says, after his teacher moves on to another town, maybe being run out of town by his the successors people, I don't know. He busied himself with obtaining books and texts and commentaries of natural and metaphysical philosophy. And the doors of knowledge began to open unto me.
I find this sentiment at the end here particularly humbling, since he's describing everything that he's learned, up to the age of 10, which is significantly more than I've learned.
Well, this is maybe 10.
up to the age of 10, he's already studied Quran and so on and so forth, and then his teens, and after all that, only then starts the doors of knowledge open to him, and I'm sitting here thinking, well, I don't learn much.
And also, it's noteworthy that he said that his way of approaching Euclid geometry was to study three or four theorems, and then he didn't need to read the rest. He just extrapolated the solutions to the rest of the geometry on his own. Okay.
ثم رغبت في علم الطب وصرت أقرأ الكتب المصنفة فيه. وعلم الطب ليس من العلوم الصعبة، فيلسوف يبحث في أصل الكون وفي الزمن ده كلام فعلا أني برزت فيه في أقل مدة حتى بدأ فضلاء الطب يقرؤون علي علم الطب وتعهدت المرض فانفتح علي من أبواب المعالجات المقتبسة من التجربة ما لا يوصف. وأنا مع ذلك أختلف إلى الفقه وأناظر فيه، وأنا في هذا الوقت من أبناء 16 سنة. 16 سنة. ثم توفرت على العلم والقراءة سنة ونصفا، فأعدت قراءة المنطق وجميع أجزاء الفلسفة. وفي هذه المدة نمت ليلة واحدة بطولها، ولا اشتغلت النهار بغيري، وجمعت بين يدي ظهورا، فكل حجة كنت أنظر فيها أثبت مقدمات قياسية ورتبتها في تلك الظهور، ثم نظرت فيما عساها تنتج، وراعيت شروط مقدماته حتى تحقق لي حقيقة الحق في تلك المسألة. وكلما كنت أتحير في مسألة ولم أكن أظفر بالحد الأوسط في قياسي، ترددت إلى الجانب وصليت وابتهلت إلى مبدع الكل حتى فتح لي المنغلق وتغسر المتعسر.
So I'll just start and can do it because it's long. So I became interested in medicine when I read many resources and books, encyclopedias about it. And this is the part where we laugh because he said, medicine is not a difficult science to learn. So he says that he excelled in it in such a short period that the scholars of medicine invited him to and started teaching him. And he started taking patients and having an experiential knowledge at the age of 16.
He started getting analysis, didn't he?
Then he started taking patients, and he discovered from experience kinds of cures that had not been written down.
And he says at the same time he is still أنا مع ذلك أختلف إلى الفقه والنظافية. At the same time I am attending these circles of jurisprudence and argumenting, discussing about it. And all of this when he was just 16 years old. ثم توفرت على العلم وقراءة سنة ونصف. I guess he devoted himself for reading for a year and a half. فأعدت قراءة المنطق. I studied logic all over again and all the parts or schools, I don't know, if there could be, of philosophy. All the branches of philosophy topics. And in this period, I only slept one full night.
How did he happen?
I think
that
he never slept a full night.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what he meant.
في هذه المدة نمت ليلة واحدة بطولها. So I and I haven't in the day basically I'm not doing anything else. لا اشتغلت نهارا بغيره. وجمعت بين يدي ظهورا. So I spent the whole day taking, studying every argument, deconstructing it, looking at all the references and evidence and orders and so promptly. And then also experimenting with certain hypotheses. And so he's basically saying he took all the arguments and put them to experience in order for the end to attain the truth. Until I reach like the truth in a certain topic.
الفقرة القادمة لأن فيها من الحداثة شيء منكسر، وكنت أرجع بالليل وكنت أرجع بالليل إلى ذلك وأضع السراج بين يدي وأشتغل بالقراءة والكتابة، فمهما غلبني النوم أو شعرت بضعفي عدلت إلى شرب قدح من الشراب ري الثمن تعود إلي قوتي، ثم أرجع إلى القراءة ومهما أخذني أدنى نوم أحلم بتلك المسائل بأعياني، حتى إن كثيرا من المسائل اتضح لي وجوهها في المنام.
صح.
يعني وكذلك حتى استحكم معي جميع العلوم ووقفت عليها. يا سلام، شكرا. اسمع بخير. وكذلك حتى استحكم معي جميع العلوم ووقفت عليها بحسب الإمكان الإنساني، بحسب الإمكان الإنساني، وكل ما علمته في ذلك الوقت فهو كما علمته الآن، لم أزدد فيه إلى اليوم، حتى أحكمت على المنطق والطبيعي والرياضي، ثم عدلت إلى الإلهي وقرأت كتاب ما بعد الطبيعة، فما كنت أفهم ما فيه والهبس علي. فضرب واضح، حتى أعدت قراءته 40 مرة وصار لي محفوظا.
Okay, let's stop here before we ruin by getting to the end of this paragraph. So we're going to translate.
Finish.
So Mr. Gamal said at the beginning that there is a spirit of modernity in the next paragraph. So he said, and I used to return at night to my house, put the lantern between my hands, and I devote myself to reading and writing. So whenever sleep overcomes me or I feel weak, I take a drink until I get my power force back, and then I return to reading.
And of course, he was talking about kapha, right?
Yeah.
By the way, when I studied here with Father Rahman, he used to tell this story. He would teach, of course, focusing on El Farabi and Ibn Sina, and then he would tell this story. And for Father Rahman, there was no doubt that
what kind
this
of
is why.
Yeah.
And he always used to chuckle about it. I don't know whether he chuckled about it with the notion that in most cases, if one is trying to work through the night and one has a glass of wine, it doesn't really succeed in what you want.
Yeah, we keep trying this experiment.
I think it's also kind of interesting, he had just finished the previous paragraph saying that when he had a difficult problem that he was perplexed with, he would go to the mosque and pray, and intensively look to help people. And then he used this kind of interesting expression, I looked at a kul, and you probably hear Muslims refer to a world without kul. I mean, that's not a Quranic expression. So he's the creator of the of kul, it's a philosophical term. And so everything is sort of opened up to me. And then you can use the second solution to figuring out your problem is just to have a glass of wine.
Well, this sounds pretty great.
Yeah.
Shut up, Yanni.
Oh, we know.
So I have a question about the expression of Qira'a, which goes way, way back. And he uses it several times here. But I wonder, is it? I'm thinking that we can read this as saying, either reading or studying with, because if he, Abu Barwiya, حَتَّى قَرَأْتُ ظُوَاهِرِ الْمَنْتَقِ عَلَيْهِ عَلَى فُلَانٍ, and then he says, أَخَذْتُ أَقْرَأَ الْكُتُبْ عَلَى نَفْسِي, which I think you have to read as, read it by myself.
No, to myself. He's teaching it to himself. He's studying with himself instead of with the teacher.
Yeah, then but that's to take qara as teach, right?
Well, as study.
Study, yeah, qara ada, someone's that study from someone.
What you would do is you would read the text, and then the teacher would correct you whenever you made a mistake. And so that was the, you read it to the person that automatically meant to study with that.
Right.
Because that's the way that the instructor was going to be. You read with somebody. It's as if you went into photo and he said, and you have to sit there with all of your the way you do. And then you were reading to him, but you were studying with him, is what you were doing.
So the mosque says bottom first page,
So he was reading it with his neck. So
it wasn't that he was reading
No, he was reading it to this teacher, who was this one who was called the Buddha Fighters.
What I'm trying to get at is just means math and why didn't this product to math?
He's reading two, but that ends up meaning that you said all of it.
No, I know that. Yeah,
I'm not
using it. Yeah, I am a mess. We have a discussion here of Ustaz Kamal about the meaning of Qira'a. What does that mean?
قرأ على يعني ممكن أقول قرأت على أستاذ مايكل أي أنني أخذت العلم من الأستاذ مايكل عندما أريد أن أقرأ كتاب أرسطو وأنا لا أفهم فأقول قرأت على الأستاذ مايكل مش أنا اللي قرأت يعني مش أنا الذي علمت أنا قرأت على يديه في كلمة هنا غائبة على يديه على بوكسيدي هو الذي أقول قرأت وهذا موجود في كل الكتب العربية أقول يقال قرأ على فلان يعني تعلم من فلان
مش لازم يدل على قراءة بالعين
لا
صفحة بالعين
لا هنا معنى معنوي معنى مجازي يعني قرأ أي قرأ الكتاب كله على فلان
على المسلم
ويقال أيضا وأجيز على فلان أجيز يعني أخذ الإجازة بالعلم
فقرأت عليه يعني
قرأت عليه
رسل معه
تعلمت على يديه
شكرا
نعم صلى الله عليه وسلم.
Okay, so we got to the point where
he's reading the metaphysics.
After he would take his evening a drink, or at other times when he would start to fall asleep, he would keep his mind focused on the problems, and that many of the solutions came to him through dreams. And I just wanted to make a link to it in the Lotterby and other of the time, that this notion of staying up and having a powerful dream life seems to have been cultivated in a particularly strong way within, across the range of intellectuals. One has to ask, in the sense of in the Larvae and others, for example, with this prodigious production, and Ibn Sina as well, where if one says, how long would it take to write as much as they wrote, they'd have to be writing all the time. So if one is constantly meditating, the Greek word is theorema, which means contemplating, but it's also the word that was used for scientific study of mathematical principles, etc. If one is constantly meditating in the Sufi sense, and not sleeping, to where the rigor of the study and the plasticity of the mind in the state of dream can come together. And I just found it fascinating to see this comment about the dreams here. And then we were about to come to the place where Ibn Sina finally acknowledges that he has a difficulty. He didn't quite get the metaphysics of Aristotle. So he read it 40 times.
And memorized it.
But it appears that still didn't do the trick, as we'll see. Any final comments or questions or thoughts before we go on to the next part? Could you continue reading about that?
Yes, I had in mind who's
talking about that. Who's that? The Tap Dog? Yeah, you know? The Tap Dog?
Yeah. مدرب نفسي حتى أعدت قراءته 40 مرة وصار لي محفوظا، وأنا مع ذلك لا أقرأ ولا المقصود به، وآيست لنفسي يأس آيست من نفسي وقلت هذا الكتاب لا سبيل إلى فهمه. وإذا أنا في يوم من الأيام حضرت وقت العصر في الورقين، الورقين هو سوق الكتب، وهذا موجود في بغداد سوق المتنبي بنفس الاسم حتى الآن. وإذا أنا في يوم من الأيام حضرت وقت العصر في الورقين، وبيان دلال مجلد ينادي عليه فعرضه عليه، فرددته ردا متبرما معتقدا أن لا فائدة من هذا العلم. فقال لي اشتري مني هذا، فإنه رخيص أبيعه بثلاثة دراهم، وصاحبه محتاج إلى ثمنه، واشتريته إلا هو كتاب لأبي نصر الفارابي في أغراض كتاب ما بعد الطبيعة، ورجعت إلى بيتي وأسرعت قراءتي، فانفتح علي في الوقت أغراض ذلك الكتاب بسبب أنه كان لي محفوظا على ظهر قلبي. هو قرار 40 مرة عشان يفهم ما فهمش. لم يفهمه إلا عندما قرأ الكتاب الفرعوني هذا الذي عثر عليه الصوت. وفرحت بذلك وتصدقت في ثاني يومه بشيء كثير على الفقراء شكرا لله تعالى. أتوقف هنا وليسمح لي الأستاذ مايكل أن أشرح تقليدا كانت الثقافة العربية أنه عندما يمتني مؤلف من قراءة كتاب صعب يتصدق على الفقراء ويذبح، يعني يذبح على الضحية ويفرق على الفقراء ويذكر الجبرتين في كتابه عجائب الآثار في التراجم والأخبار أن السيد مرتضى الزبيدي اليمني نزيل القاهرة في ما قبل الحملة الفرنسية في القرن 18 وبعد أن ألف كتابه جواهر القاموس لشرح القاموس، شرح القاموس الذي هو القاموس المحيط، هو أسان مرتضى الزبيدي وضع له شرحا في 40 مجلدة وقد طبعته دولة الكويت. فبعد أن انتهى من التأليف والشرح ذبح بقرا وغنما ووزعه على الفقراء وأكلت القاهرة كلها من الأضحية بتاعت هو كان ميسور، كان ميسورا في يعني هذا تقليد ان الحفل بالعلم يتبعه الأكل يعني بالصدقة.
كان في العراق لما الابن خلص الجامعة يذبحه
لسه بالأمس كنت أتحدث إلى أخي في مصر وهو رجل هو مهندس كان جنرال في الجيش ولكن هو عنده تصوف يعني كتير فقلت له وقال لي ما أخبارك قلت له هذا الأسبوع أنتهي من الكورس يعني في جامعة شيكاغو فقال لي كان الحال كويس كتير جدا يعني هذا موفق والطلبة كويسين والجامعة كويسة جدا فقال لي تضيف حاجة من ده أنا نويت والله بقى أنا
Okay, so
as a tablet.
So the last point, he was talking to a colleague in Egypt who asked him about Chicago, right. And he said it was fine. And then what was the end?
Pardon?
What did he say at the end?
He said, "I'm gonna sacrifice."
So at the end of finishing a large project, Asraf Kamal mentioned this example of a 16th century Egyptian scholar who finished a shark on the shark, a massive dictionary. In 40 volumes, and when he finished it, he gave as a alms to the poor enough meat to feed all of Cairo. I don't know what the population of Cairo is at that time, but it's probably still was considerable.
كتاب السيد المرتضى الزبيدي اسمه تاج العروس لشرح جواهر القاموس. تاج العروس بشرح جواهر القاموس والقاموس المقصود هو المحيط للفيروز أبادي لكن القاموس المحيط أستاذ مايك قد كده يعني حجمه صغير مرتضى الزبيدي 40 مبلغ، يعني عمر في عمر. أحيانا يكون الشرح أضعاف الأصل في كثير من الكتب العربية الكبرى. نعود إلى ابن سينا.
لكن هل تجمع
وفرحت بذلك وتصدقت في ثاني يومه بشيء كثير على الفقراء شكرا لله تعالى. وكان سلطان بخارى في ذلك الوقت نوح ابن منصور، واتفق له مرض التج الأطباء فيه، وكان اسمي اشتهر بينهم بالتوفر على القراءة، فأجروا الذكر بين يديه وسألوه إخباري، فحضرت وشاركتهم في مداواته وتوسعت بخدمته. فسألته يوما الإذن لي في دخول دار كتبهم ومطالعتها وقراءة ما فيها من كتب الطب، فأذن لي. فدخلت دارا ذات بيوت كثيرة، في كل بيت صناديق كتب منضبة بعضها على بعض، في بيت منها كتب العربية والشعر، وفي الآخر الفقه، وكذلك في كل بيت كتب علم مفرد.
Okay, so what we would like to do now is resume the translation of the paragraph. As you got, after having read the metaphysics 40 times, I thought this was a very interesting literary point. He went, he was in the souk, the bookseller souk of Warapé, and the bookseller came up with a book and said, try this. And he said, I've given up on that. There's no use in any of it. He was in a state of despair or not understanding the metaphysics. I said, give it a chance. It's only three dirham. And what I liked was the second part. It's only three dirhams. And the man who owns it needs to sell it. So, in other words, he said it's inexpensive, but he suggested that he would be doing a good deed by buying it. And it's not clear to me, what is he suggesting, that he only bought it, you know, to be nice. Who knows? But then he saw, it was a commentary by Al-Farabi on metaphysics. He memorized the metaphysics, so that when he got the clue from Farabi, Al-Farabi, he understood it. And who would like to tell us then what happened with the Sultan?
Well, first of all, he's so happy that he makes the sacrifice.
So I turned to my house and quickened to reading it. The subjects or the ideas of the book opened up to me immediately because I already learned it by heart. I became so thrilled that I, on the second day, like, this is what Jamel spoke about, the ritual of like sacrificing a sheep by giving the meat to the poor after you finish and you understand the book. So Ibn Sina did that. And so now the second part. And then at that time, the Sultan of Bukhara was Nuh ibn Mansur. He became sick with a disease that all the doctors of his court couldn't cure. My name started to become famous amongst them. كان اسمي اشتهر بينهم. So they mentioned my name and they said, like, why don't we bring Ibn Sina to try? So I came and participated in trying to find the cure. And one day I asked him the favor of to allow me to enter the main library to read all the books of medicine they have. So he gave me the permission. So I entered the Daran, like house, with many rooms. In every room there are like many boxes with books ordered next to each other, one next to the other. In one book, in one house, there is books about Arabic and poetry, in another, books about jurisprudence. And this way, every room was devoted to one subject.
So, any thoughts on this? And this notion that he discovered a library and that he had never really known about libraries before, but because he was a type of medicine to the Sultan, he got to go into the Dar Kutub, and there before him was something that it sounds like he never conceived of. A whole institution with books arranged by discipline in different rooms. Any thoughts on this passage? Questions? Yes.
Well, I think it's interesting how secondary medicine is. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is not, he doesn't tell you what the sickness was. He's not interested in telling you about the curing. He's interested in talking about books. And medicine was an easy task to learn anyway.
You know, he says that. And whom I disagree, but if you're called to cure the Sultan, I would imagine there's some pressure.
Yeah.
If you give him a medicine and it makes him sicker, it might not be. He might not get into the library, he might not get out of the jail. So, Ustad Kamal, what do you think about this notion that he's got the clue to his being able to access the library was that he was a personal physician to the Sultan? He says medicine is no big deal. It's easy. But some people didn't succeed. And if you didn't succeed with someone very powerful, you could pay a price. Could you translate my question?
يقول لنا ابن سينا أنه سمح عندما قدم الدواء إلى السلطان سمح له ذلك بالدخول إلى المكتبة وفي سياق حديثه هو يعطي الأهمية الكاملة للقراءة قبل الطب وقبل إيجاد الدواء فالدواء والطب كان وسيلة كي يصل إلى المكتب فما رأيك في هذا أن القراءة قبل الطب؟
لا هو قرأ
الطب ولكن الطب السؤال أنه الطب في حد ذات نفسه ما هو إلا وسيلة كي يصل إلى المكتب؟
مستعد دعمل أي حاجة في عصر يعني هو رجل لم يخدع هو تقدم وعلى السلطان وأخذ إذنا بدخول المكتبة فيها أسرار يعني فيها كتب غير متداولة فهو أصبح أكثر علما بالطب وأكثر علما بالفلسفة فمن الذي استفاد جموع القراء
سو جميل
أنا أوافق على السلوك
Yes,
maybe this is along the lines of what Murr was getting at, but what is it about Aristotle's metaphysics that compels him to stay at it, to memorize it, to read it 40 times, to buy this, this introduction? And why that?
Nathaniel, would you translate?
The man died, it seemed like
لماذا هذا العمل بالذات؟ ما الخصائص التي دعاه إلى طلب منه مثل هذه الجهود؟
كتاب الله وراء الطبيعة ويقول أنه اهتم بهذا الكتاب قرأه 40 مرة بحث عن تفسير فالسؤال هو لماذا هو مهتم بهذا الكتاب؟
لأنه هو كان
لماذا هذا الكتاب
بالذات
وكان أساسا في النسوخ يعني الطب ليس هو الهدف الطب كان جزءا من تكوين العلم لكن ابن سينا أنا قرأت موسوعة ابن سينا بدأ في تحقيقه في مصر سنة 49 وحققها أو أشرف على تحقيقها الدكتور إبراهيم بنومي مذكور وحتى الآن لم تكتمل طبع منها حوالي 25 مجلد وحتى الآن لم تكتمل طيب واحد هيسألني أنت دلوقتي ماذا ستستفيد من قراءة ابن سينا أهم ما كتب عن الزمن قضيتي سؤالي الشخصي سؤالي المعقد أهم ما كتب عن الزمن في التراث العربي في موضعين في كتاب الطبيعة والسماع والطبيعة هو جزء من موسوعة الشفاء الموسوعة كلها اسمها الشفاء في مجلد اسمه السماع والطبيعيات هناك فصل مهم جدا عن الزمن في هذا الكتاب
حتى المفكر
نعم النص الثاني عشان أخلص المرة النص الثاني عن الزمن في إخوان الصبر في إخوان الصبر وأنا حافظه مستعد أقوله يعني لو أنتوا مستعدين لا هو ذهب لكي يريد أن يفهم الكتاب المعقد هذا الذي حفظه قرأه 40 مرة الذي فكر أسرار الكتاب كتاب قد كده كتاب صغير جدا ومع بالمناسبة مطبوع في دار المعارف هو كتاب نصر الدين الفراغ هو أعطاه السر
All right, let me just mention a couple points. The question about why was he so obsessed with this one work, and instead Rabaul said that this is the major work for a philosophy at that period, the metaphysics of Aristotle. It was the clue, it was the kind of, I could extrapolate the linchpin of the arch. Keystone, and then Ustad Gamal mentioned that the Shifa of Ibn Sina is massive volume, coming out in many volumes.
And it's going to book it. And it's going to book it. For the mathematics, for the Falak, for the
I also and that I would notice that the title he gives, The Healing, is very interesting. Given our discussion about philosophy and medicine. But Ustad Gamal was mentioning, and I think this links directly to your own writing, because the literary critics of Ustad Gamal have pointed out that the use of time in Gamal Bihani's writings is extraordinary in the way it's conceived, the way it is moved, Ustad Gamal was saying that he read this multi-volume work, and it's wonderful to talk to Gamal about these things because he always remembers the name of the editor and the name of the publisher, whatever the work was, and then he said that the best discussions of time he's ever read are the discussion of time in the volume of the physics, the Tabia, in Ibn Sina, and the discussion of time in the Ikhwan Islam. I thought that in this way our discussion has gone through
Ibn Sina, and has touched on a really critical aspect in the development of the modern fiction within the works of Kamal Gitani. We are running a little bit late.
في شبه بين ابن سينا وبين وضع أنا قرأت بدون أستاذ. أنا كنت أقرأ من دار الكتب مباشرة، لكن كان الكتاب يرشدني إلى كتاب. يعني أنا عندما قرأت ابن سينا الطبيعيات كنت أبحث عن في موضوع يعني أريد أن أقرأ عن الزمن، فوجدت إنه في يعني في مقدمة الشفاء يشير إلى الطبيعيات، وفي إخوان الصفا أنا كنت قرأت إخوان الصفا كلها وكنت مستمتع، فلما قرأت إخوان الصفا وجدت نصا عن الزمن. هل أقرأ؟ مستعد أقرأ من الذاكرة. يعني أريد أن أقول أنا كنت عصامي في قراءتي، يعني لا يوجد الأستاذ، أنا لم أدرس هذا في الجامعة، أنا درسته مع نفسي.
So, Steph Kamal was mentioning that, that there's an aspect of Ibn Sina in his own life that are similar in the sense that Ustaz Kamal did not study in the university these texts. He came to them on his own. He studied them on his own by going to the library or getting the texts from wherever he could find them. He was driven by a desire to learn or to study the works about time. He saw in an introduction to Ibn Sina's Shifa that there was a discussion in physics, and that and Ikhwan al-Safa came together in his own reading without having a course, not studying Allah. Anybody? But I just want to ask, so if you study on your own at Ibn Sina, and then you write a novel, how many animals did you sacrifice after finishing Zaidi Barakat and the other novels?
Tajaliyat min Ibn Adam. Ibn Sina.
I think that we need to close. There's one paragraph that talks about strange circumstances of
أستاذ مايكل. yes. أريد أن أشير فقط إلى شخص أنا مدين له. أنا عندما خرجت من الجمالية وأنا لا أعرف يعني أريد أن أعرف الأدباء، فقبلت نجيب معه وأنا كنت محظوظ، قبلت وأنا عندي 14 سنة. لكن في شخص آخر غير معروف غير مشهور كان يقيم ندوة كل يوم نحر، وهو أول من نشر لي في مصر. نشرت في 18 يوليو 63، هو الأستاذ أمين الخوري. هذا الرجل كان يعمل ندوة وهو تلميذ مباشر للإمام محمد عبد، وكان يلتقي للكتاب. وأنا كان عندي 15 سنة، فكنت أذهب وأضع قلم على قلم وأناقشه، والرجل يناقشني، يعني لم يمنعني ولم، لكن تعلمت منه يعني أنا هو الذي دلني على ابن سينا. عندما سألته عن الزمن قال لي روح دار الكتب واقرأ ابن سينا وبس. يعني فابن سينا جاب إخوان الصفا، جاب بعد ذلك نصوص أخرى عن الزمن، مثلا نظرية الإسماعيلية في الزمن وفي فكرة في الفلسفة الإسماعيلية مهمة جدا، وجدتها في مذكرات المؤيد للدين داعي الدعاء. هذه ترجمة خاصة، ترجمة زي الأوتوبيوغرافي وهكذا.
So he, Kamal was saying that if you wanted to correct one thing, that he did have an important teacher, Amin Khoury.
Amin Khoury.
Amin Khoury, who was the direct student of Muhammad Abdu, the great modernist Egyptian writer. And that when Kamal was, what, 15? 15 years old.
It was in 1959.
Okay. So, Kamal... 14, 15. Yeah, about 15. Kamal would come up to Amin Khoury and ask him questions, and he said that Amin Khoury completely engaged with him, and it was and taught him whatever he asked him to teach, and told him, when he asked about time, he said, and by the way, this is an assignment for everybody that's here. He said, go to the library and read Ibn Sina's discussion of time in his Shifat. We have to stop here, Kamal. Because you have another talk. We're talking about time.
أذكر في السنين فقط. يعني أنا أمين الخوري عرفته شخصيا. هو مات سنة 66. لكن في شيخ آخر مهم جدا من شيوخ الأزهر، هو متخصص في البلاغة، وكان عنده موقف متقدم جدا من المرض، كتب ضد الحجاب في الثلاثينات، اسمه الشيخ عبد المتعال الصعيدي. اكتبوا هذا الاسم، الشيخ عبد المتعال الصعيدي، كان يكتب في مجله الرساله، وكان استاذ كبير في الازهر، افكاره تعتبر متقدمه جدا حتى الان. لكن ما هو مات يعني أنا لم أعرفه، لكن قرأت كل كتب في البلاغة. هو شيخ عظيم ومتقدم جدا، وكتبه موجودة تطبع باستمرار في مصر.
So Ustaz Kamal very much wants to memorialize some of these important figures in Egypt. And that the next one besides Amin Khoury was a Sheikh of Al-Azhar who wrote Kamal considers a brilliant work on rhetoric in Arabic, Balada. And he never got to meet this Sheikh because the Sheikh had died before his time, but he studied all of his works. And he wanted to recall to us the importance of that particular shape. And now, Kamal, can we go to your next muhadara?
Okay.
Cool. So we will take 3 minutes, and then we will have a discussion of its arrival.
We thank you for listening to or viewing our podcast. For more information and for other podcasts, please see our website, divinity.uchicago.edu/podcasts. Copyright, the University of Chicago Divinity School.